Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to United Church of Christ in Boxborough. So glad that you are here this morning. It is good to gather together and celebrate the love of community and the love of God. Welcome to all of those of you gathered here in the sanctuary, all of you gathered on Zoom, and those who will be participating in some other time online. We are a community without space and time bounds in this new world that we're in. So glad that you are here. I'm the Reverend Cindy Maybeck, your Bridge Interim Minister, and I encourage you to, I was going to say look at the announcements, but we had a little photocopier issue with a lightning bolt, so be sure to watch your email for all of the good announcements. I will mention that in my ministry, I preach at a lot of different places. It was by the grace of God that I had this much time available for Boxborough, but next Sunday, I was already booked to be preaching in Rochester, New Hampshire. So I will not be here next Sunday. Our chair of deacons, Larry, will be offering the sermon. I will be in the office this Tuesday and next Tuesday, so I'm not too far away. I would invite, is Jim Howie in the house? Would you come and tell us about that Merry Christmas bear?
You know, the fair has a little bit something for everybody. We have food, we have gifts. So invite your friends and come volunteer for the fair. No skill levels are required. We need all the help we can get. The other thing I would mention is this year for the fair, we're giving 10% away to the Boston area gleaners. So I know a lot of the fair chairs and other people have been working very hard already, but please sign up. There's a sign up sheet in the gathering room, so please sign up. We need all the help we can get, and plan on coming on Saturday, November 18th from 9 to 1, and bring a couple friends. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. And Glynis, would you share with us some good news about this afternoon's events?
Now I'm on, yeah. So this year, the Faith in Action team will be holding our monthly meetings on Sunday mornings with the hope that some of you would join us for part of the meeting. And today is our first Sunday meeting. It'll be at 10:45 in the Pipe Room. And each month when we have a meeting, we're going to start with a focus topic that we hope will be of special interest to some of you. So our topic for today is the motivation behind the walk against hate, which will be taking place this afternoon. So we invite you to the Pipe Room at 10:45. You can bring your coffee, and also to join us at 2 p.m. for the walk against hate. Thank you.
Anyone else have an announcement this morning to share with the community of faith? And let us continue our worship in music.
Oh, morning.
Good morning.
I am Hrit, and I am delighted to be your lay reader this morning. And we are going to start with a call to worship. Let's thank the Lord, for the Lord is good. God's love endures forever. Who can proclaim the mighty acts of the Lord or fully declare God's praise? Blessed are those who act justly, who always do what is right. Our God is worthy of our praise. Remember us, O Lord, when you show favor to your people, that we may enjoy your blessings. Let us worship our God, who blesses us with infinite love and abundant grace. Amen. And now for everybody who could rise, we are going to sing from the Black New Century Hymnal, There's a Wideness in God's Mercy, and you find the text in your bulletin, and it's number 23. Now the centering prayer. Lord Jesus, we gather to worship you today with hearts full of joy and appreciation for the beauty of nature, for your diversity and extravagant welcome. We invite your Holy Spirit to this space to celebrate your goodness and presence in our gathering time together. Prepare our hearts to receive what you have for us today. Amen. And now we invite you to name God in whatever way has most meaning for you, and say this prayer in the version that speaks to you the most. Frankly, I would like to say it in Dutch, but I couldn't even fully remember the words in Dutch, nor would you understand, and it would be confusing, so I'll keep it to English. But let's. Creator God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We invite you to greet each other online, through the Zoom chat box, or in person with a wave, a bow, or a high five. And we conclude then the passing of the peace with a song of celebration. God's peace be with you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I wanted to introduce you to my bears. I have Snowball, and I have... Where's Felix?
I think I've seen
him. Oh, well, thank goodness. Where? This is Felix. Were you hiding? Why? He doesn't want to be here. Because Snowball is here. You two have not been getting along, have you? You've been watching a lot of news, haven't you? Didn't Mommy tell you to turn the news off? Okay, so what's going on? Can we talk to church? You're glad to be at church. I know you are. You like church. Okay. Well, Snowball was sad this week. How many were sad when you watched the news this week? Snowball was very, very sad. When people are hurt, Snowball's sad. Snowball doesn't like seeing people harmed, scared, right? Taken away. It was very, very scary. It was sad. And, oh, you weren't sad, were you? He was mad. Felix was really, really angry. He thought it was wrong for people to come and break into other people's houses. And he also thinks it's wrong to go to war. And everything is wrong and everything is bad. How many people today were angry? Oh, yes. And how can we be friends when we're sad and angry? By coming to church. Well, here's the thing. The other thing that Snowball and Felix have been arguing about is that Snowball has been really, really concerned about, I know, friends in Tel Aviv and the Jews who are in Israel, I know, and Felix has been really concerned about friends in Palestine and friends that are in Gaza and have to be evacuated, and we're not gonna argue about it in church, kids. How many of you have felt conflicted about which side to pay attention to? It has been a really hard week. And it's been hard to know how to talk to people who watch different news channels than you do, isn't it? Yeah. And you just kept arguing, and you just kept turning on the TV. And I know you were sad. I know, and you were angry. But you know what? It's okay to be sad. When you come to church, it's okay to be angry when you come to church, because this is a church with open doors where everyone is welcome, where we come as we are. And so we're with God when we're sad, and we're with God when we're angry, and we're with God when we don't know how peace is going to happen. So you too, you've been hiding and you've been sitting in the front row like you are just some bag of chips and something else. Can you two be friends? Because you know what I heard about this church? There's a playground. Is that true? Yeah. Would someone be so kind to take the two bears to the playground for the service? I think that would be better. And you can listen to your mommy if you want to, or you can pray and play and read books. Thank you. Please join me in a spirit of prayer. Gracious God, we give you thanks that we are safe here to be in your love. We give you thanks for hearing our sorrow, for hearing us when we're mad, and for hearing us when we want peace. We ask you to bless us in all of our confusion and in our clarity, and that you would be present in this precious congregation, in this church, with your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The scripture this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 1 to 14, and I would like to share it with you by heart. It goes like this. Once more, Jesus was speaking to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, tell those who have been invited, look, my dinner is ready. My oxen and fatted calves have been slaughtered. Everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet." But they made light of it, and they went away, one to his farm, one to his business. And the rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged, and he sent his troops, and he destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, "Well, the wedding is ready, and those invited were not worthy. So go, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet." Those servants went into the streets and gathered all whom they found, good and bad, so that the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. He said, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?" He was speechless. Then the king said to his attendants, "Bind him hand and foot, throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen." Here ends the telling of God's blessed word. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So this parable of Jesus begins with an image of the kingdom of heaven as a king giving a wedding banquet, a feast, a celebration, if you will, for his son. He goes out to call those who've been invited who say, check my calendar, too busy. And I do think that is often us. We are so often invited to practice our spirituality, but perhaps we're too busy, or perhaps we have something else going on, or perhaps we don't remember that we had promised ourselves that we would take a discipline of prayer or offer to visit, or there's so much more to do than we do. And then those guests not only don't show up, they kill the servants. And I do wonder, when we make those decisions about whether or not to engage in a spiritual community, are we somehow putting the other in a stereotype? Are there ways that we divide up our churches and denominations and religions that in its essence, kill them by stereotyping them and not seeing each other as true siblings in love? Well, the king responds with violence, which frankly is a difficult scripture telling to tell you this week when the news is so full of violence in Israel. And then tries again and invites everyone. So everyone comes, and there's one fellow who's not wearing the right clothes. And I have to say, well, he wasn't given a whole lot of notice. Maybe the tuxedo shop was closed. But it may be that this idea of a wedding robe is a metaphor for righteousness. Is it possible that this fellow comes into that banquet not in the right spirit of love, maybe with an agenda or an assumption of what's happening, or somehow not holding the grace and humility to which we are invited to a banquet? I wonder. At any rate, he is speechless. You know, the Syrophoenician woman would have spoken up. Just saying. He's speechless. We don't know his part of the story. And off he goes into the darkness. And there's that weeping and gnashing of teeth. You know, biblical storytellers don't get to pick and choose. We tell all the scripture, and some mornings are harder than others. And yet the place that Matthew puts this parable in the gospel is that Jesus tells this story after he's ridden into Jerusalem on the donkey, the triumphal entry, after he's flipped over the tables in the temple because he's so angry at how people are misusing the power of God, after he has had really hard conversations with the most rigid and well thought of religious colleagues in his community, he is coming up on the culmination of the story. We're about to go to the cross. Things are getting intense. This story is intense. There is an urgency. And you know, there's part of me that actually leans into that. If only there were urgency. Like we need peace now, like we need a new way to be human beings, like we have to stop being so divided in the name of God, that we have to find another way to care for one another when there is generations, multi-generations of trauma with those who have suffered anti-Semitism, with those who have suffered racism. It is all so complex, but there's a part of me that is like, yes, we urgently need a new way of being today. And from there, I might be able to tell people who are over there how to do it. Oops. Here's what I know about spirituality. There is no way that I can ask something that I am not willing to do myself. And if I want the kind of world in which people truly love one another and find ways of peace, I'm talking about loving your enemy and praying for those who persecute you. I cannot ask that unless in my own life I find the most difficult conversations and walk into those with humility, grace, and love. Can I tell you a story? The true story. 20 years ago, actually. And I was in the minister's council. It was one of the most exciting gatherings of clergy I'd ever been to. People from all over the United States and Puerto Rico, different cultural backgrounds, languages, different theologies, different kinds of economic status, just such a diverse group of folks. The worship was amazing. And the people, it was like the cream of the cream of the clergy came to this particular event. And it was just amazing. I went as a delegate for a couple of years. And the third year that I went, there had been a bylaw change suggested by the clergy in the Southwest. This would be Arizona and New Mexico. And the bylaw change that they wanted basically said, no clergy person can be a delegate unless they are in a marriage between one man and one woman, or if they're single, they are celibate. And that was going to be the discussion in the plenary. Well, before I could decide what to do next, I was the chairperson of the Professional Effectiveness Committee that year, and I got a call from the executive director who said, "Cindy, I'm really sorry to bring you this news, but the executive committee met and we are asking you to please step down as chair of the committee. You can't be on it this year." And I'm thinking, yeah, he's not saying it, but I think it's because as a lesbian in a relationship with one woman and one woman, I'm not neutral. So I called my spiritual advisors and leadership coaches and talked to my partner, Elaine, and spent time in prayer and tried to figure out a really good reason to not to go, because there were so many, except that I sensed that God wanted me to go. And so I got on a plane by myself and I went. We had committee meetings every day, and I sat in the committee. Another delegate from Massachusetts was the chair. Our topic was to update the clergy code of ethics. You can't make this stuff up. And I was patient and quiet and accommodating. And when there was information that I had as chair, I would gently give that when it was necessary. And I was just, well, I was me. And the second day, a fellow comes up to me and he said he wanted to introduce himself to me. He was, his name was Scott, and he was from West Virginia, the delegates who had helped to bring this new bylaw revision. And that he had been watching me. And he saw that I had a sense of grace and humility, and he was just, clearly the Spirit of Christ was upon me, and he was, frankly, he was surprised that I came. And I said, surprise. And he said, I wonder if we could talk before the evening session. And I said, sure, Scott, we can talk. You see, the executive committee knew that this was going to be a very tense week, and they had set up a special prayer room. It was a meeting room in the hotel, and they had turned off the fluorescent lights overhead and put in a bunch of floor lamps where soft golden orbs of light would fall. And there was a table, and on it was an open Bible and a couple of battery-operated candles and one of those green batik scarves circled around with a cross standing in the center of it. And there were some comfy chairs. And so Scott and I sat down in these comfy chairs and both took a breath, and we shared the way clergy do. Where'd you go to seminary? Tell me about your call to ministry. We talked about our churches and the moments where we really felt we were making a difference in someone's life and some of those frustrations that didn't go away. And we shared the good times and the hard times and all that kind of thing that colleagues often share. And we came to the end of the conversation, and Scott said, could we pray together? And I'm here to tell you, my heart dropped out of my chest through the chair and underneath the floor. Because one of the most spiritually abusive acts that I have received is when someone prays to God to change that part of my soul, that sexual, spiritual, embodied, incarnated part of my soul that makes me who I am as a woman, loving woman. To change that as though it were wrong. So I surrendered, came back into my body, and internally tipped my face to heaven and asked. God said, yes. Said, yes, we can pray. And we took hands. This is before COVID. Remember, we touched people's hands. We took hands. And he prayed. God prayed that God would bless my church in Northborough and bring so many more teenagers, because we were building this youth ministry, and that God would bless my preaching that had so much love and power, and that God would bless the leaders in that church who had been so courageous in calling me, and that God would bless my partner and our dog and the parsonage and the church and all of the ministry. And I prayed for Scott that God would bless his church and bless the five different Bible studies and bless his sound biblical preaching that came from the core of who he was, and bless the men's fellowship and the mission work they were doing with that good work in El Salvador, and that God would bless his wife and his four children and his mother-in-law who had just gone in for treatment for cancer, and that God would bless his ministry today and forevermore. And we shared the Lord's Prayer together and said, Amen. I don't really remember the evening session, what happened that night. I do remember the worship was wonderful. I do remember the plenary was terrible. We tabled the discussion for the next year so we could draw it out. The final committee meeting, and the chairperson led us in some farewells and some gratitudes. We got up to leave, and I came across Scott, and I said, Scott, I want to thank you. I look forward to seeing you next year. He said, no, I won't be here next year. But Cindy, I do look forward to seeing you again. I said, oh, when will I see you again? He said, Cindy, I look forward to seeing you again. When the last trumpet sounds, and you and I are standing side by side before that throne of glory with the King of God. I said, oh, Scott, I look forward to that day too, when you and I are standing side by side in the kingdom of God. And so we parted ways. But I'll tell you what, I can still see that trumpet. I still have hope for that day. I'll never stop hoping. I'll always keep my heart open, even in dangerous places. I continue to pray. And I know there are others who pray for me. May it be so. This time I invite the choir forward for the end.
friends, we have the opportunity to
share with one another joys and concerns, those joys with which we wish to share with the community of faith, as well as concerns for which we ask prayer. Do we have joys and concerns this morning?
I want a really great joy for the members of the church that for the senior luncheon we hosted on Wednesday. I know it was the first time there were a bunch of people that participated. So the servers, the food, and Scott showed up with a high-tech karaoke thing he did. The Reverend Cindy gave a nice little parable. And I have been at the either of the worker or as a teacher, 50 to 100 senior lunches over the years. This is one of the best. It's the ball out of the park for the first time. So thank you to everybody.
Thank you to everyone who put on the senior luncheon on Wednesday, all of those who served food, those thanks to Todd who did karaoke, and there was a storyteller right here, and just thank you for that community. It was a wonderful, wonderful event. Thank you, thank you. Other, yes. Please pray for Cheryl's friend Linda, who is undergoing heart surgery as well as having breast cancer, and for her brother Michael, who is in the ICU. Pray for healing for all of those. Other concerns or joys? Please pray for Karen, who is fighting breast cancer, and can we also offer a joy for high school friends keeping in touch? There's nothing like that. The Freebie Market is a wonderful joy. Keep Heather in your prayers, and the last market of the season will be Saturday, so you don't want to miss the Freebie Market. Yes, thank you for that. Yes, yes.
We're really happy. Riley Sue has a new baby sister as of Wednesday. Phoebe was born on Wednesday.
Phoebe?
Phoebe.
Praise God that Phoebe was born, and praise God for being an older sister. Other concerns or joys or concerns? Yes. Pray for her mother-in-law, Janet, who had a cancerous mole on her nose, which will be removed in a month. So that's a lot of time to worry. So prayers that that go well. Other concerns? Then let us gather. Yes. Praise God for a cup of coffee, which may mean some reconciliation. Praise God for those moments of open doors. Do I have anything from the Zoom chat? Do I have some from Ralph? Yeah.
Celebrating my family who arrived on Wednesday in the midst of the London airport all day. Any chaos in my life the last 4 days. They have all returned home. Of course, Wednesday was a fun for them.
Praise God for family gathering together and even the chaos that ensues when they are, and travel blessings on their return home. Let us lift other joys and concerns that may be silent in your heart, and let us lift those to God. Gracious God, we give you thanks for your presence here in our midst. We give you thanks for the joy and fellowship of community senior luncheons. We give you thanks for the service this church offers to the community. We give you thanks for those who serve in the freebie market and those who come. We give you thanks for open doors. We give you thanks for ministry in this in-between transition time. We give you thanks that whoever comes or goes, Lord, you are always here, always steadfast. We pray for the many who are fighting cancer. We pray for those who are in the ICU, for those who may be facing surgery. We pray for those grieving the death of a good friend. Pray for those who are struggling with mental health. We pray for relationships and friendships that may be strained. We give you thanks for those moments of possible reconciliation. We pray that you would teach us humility. Teach us how to be the first to forgive. Teach us the difference between forgiving and being a doormat. That's not what you ask. But you do ask for humility. So show us how to set our will down to follow yours. Show us how to be wise in our discernment. Show us how not to idolize our feelings of comfort, but nudge us to be in uncomfortable conversations, in uncomfortable settings, in places where our view may not be the majority. Lord, we pray for those in Israel who suffered the attacks by Hamas. We pray for those who do not know the location or status or health of their family members. We pray for those who have not been able to be in touch with those they love. We pray for those who are hostages. We pray for those who are imprisoned, for those in Gaza, the Palestinians who have had to evacuate, for those on both sides, all sides, who have suffered death and grief and injury and loss of homes. Forgive us, God, your people. Show us how to love. I know we ask again and again and again. Please show us again. We so long for this community of humanity to be better than we've been. So if there's a corner in this week in our little space of the world where we can speak a word of kindness or take a step toward justice, or offer some solace and comfort, please, Lord, use our voices, our hands, our feet, our hearts, our lives, our homes. Let us be your love in the world. We pray this urgently in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All we have comes from you, O Lord. So we give our offerings and tithes with generous hearts in thanksgiving for all you do for us. And may these gifts given today offer hope in proclaiming and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with all the world. At this time, let us receive our morning offering. Let us pray. Take our offerings and tithes, O God. Bless them that they may be used to share your love and blessing in our community and in the world. May these offerings provide for the least of these needs and the proclamation of your word to those seeking hope. Amen. now may the love of the Creator sustain you. May the peace of Jesus flow through you. May the presence of the Holy Spirit fill you with grace and give you the courage to share the good news. My friends, go in peace. Amen.